Fantastic finales. This is a new lecture program with recorded selections. It is with a great sense of relief that we approach the end of 2020, a year that has been a time of conflict, crisis, and concern for all of us. Fortunately, there is every good reason to expect that the new year will renew our spirit of hope and joy. One of the medicines that has brought us comfort and consolation has been music, the music of the great composers. So at this time, I'd like to present for you a joyous conclusion to the old year with a spirit-lifting collection of fantastic finales extracted from the symphonic literature we all love so much. Experienced composers know that they can expect their audiences to be made up of a mixture of three general types. One, the person who goes to concerts because his wife bought season tickets. Two, the person who really and truly loves music and is familiar with the items on the concert program or willing to listen to a totally new piece and give it a chance. Three, the person who just enjoys going to concerts, doesn't know much about anything of the music, likes some things, doesn't like other things, very subjective, and is ready to go home. But in all three cases, the composer knows that all three types will be looking forward to the end of the piece, each one for different reasons. The first, because he knows that when the music gets loud and fast, it will soon end. The second had thoroughly enjoyed the music so familiar to him or her, and now anticipates the brilliant conclusion or summing up of the piece that will inspire enthusiastic applause. The third appreciates the musical dessert, a kind of reward for sitting patiently through a work of whatever length, and this should be the best part. During the grand period in music known to us as the Classical Age, dominated by the orchestral works of Franz Joseph Haydn and Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, the symphonies of these masters were easily comprehensible to their audiences in terms of understanding and appreciation. You didn't need program notes or a pre-concert lecture. You pretty much knew that, as was common practice, you would be hearing four movements, more or less, each one usually clearly defined by such brief titles as Adagio Allegro, Andante, Minuet, and a final Allegro Molto, pretty much in that order. Slow and solemn to begin with, and then bright and cheerful. Next, a contrastingly slow movement at a walking pace. The next would be a kind of light-spirited dance music item, or a sprightly scherzo, a joke. And finally, for most audiences, a concluding allegro molto e vivace, very lively, loud, and fast. In a word, a kind of formula that seemed to work every time, depending largely on the genius and versatility of the composer to make each new symphony somehow different than the previous one. For Papa Haydn, this had become a monumental task, considering his advancement from the first few rather juvenile symphonies to those extending somewhat over the 100 mark. As you survey his symphonic catalog, you begin early on to encounter nicknames intended to inspire audience appeal and even musical gimmicks to thrill, delight, and arouse the drowsy listener. Mozart fell far short of his contemporary at less than 50 symphonies, but then keep in mind that he lived a very rather short life. Had he lived as long as Haydn, he also might have reached that 100 mark, and oh, what grand symphonies those would have been, considering the monumentality of the last three. When Beethoven came on the scene toward the end of the 18th century, he quickly broke the traditional mold of the symphony by creating the most expansive, complex, and demanding works involving the largest orchestral forces up to that time. He literally took the symphony out of the intimate palatial estate and into the concert hall. So from that point on, future composers often made the necessary realization that they had to reward their patient and sometimes long-suffering listeners with a wake-up, crash-bang finale to send them on their way, blissfully content that their ticket price and their tolerance had been worth it. Not all composers chose to follow this formula, but on the other hand, a great many did. And thus we begin our exploration of my personal selection of several highly charged fantastic finales. My focus consists of a dozen finales from the symphonic literature, allowing myself only two digressions outside this genre to present two particular favorites. Having said that, we must therefore direct our attention to Ludwig van Beethoven himself, with reference to a rather unfamiliar, unexpected symphonic fantastic finale. It is a curious fact that the most popular of Beethoven's 9 works in this genre are those bearing odd numbers. The number 3, the Eroica, the ta-da-da-dum of the 5th, forgive me for skipping over the lovely pastoral number 6, it doesn't fit my scheme, to the number 7, and finally to number 9, the choral symphony. I'm referring, of course, to the magnificent symphony number 7, which deserves much more attention than it is generally given. It is an exceptional masterpiece in rhythm, joy, unbridled energy, and brilliant orchestration, inspiring Richard Wagner, who once, upon hearing it for the first time, described it most appropriately as the apotheosis of the dance. Beethoven himself regarded it as his best work upon its completion in 1812. In Joan Chissell's notes, which accompany the André Previn recording with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, she says, "Its tale is of an unquenchable spirit able to surmount all personal tribulation in the sheer exultation of being alive and part of the great goings-on of nature and of human affairs. Much of its life force stems from rhythm. Each movement is to a great extent propelled by the striking rhythm of its main theme. In the concluding A major Allegro con brio, it's almost too orgiastic to be contained. Most of the music's driving force stems from the propulsive, repetitive swirlings of the opening theme, ending with the blasting FFFF climaxes of the coda." Although I originally decided that I would restrict my survey to one composer per work, I could not resist offering Mr. Beethoven a well-deserved second choice. Not merely because his Symphony No. 9 is one of the greatest works in the literature, it ends with a massive choral finale unprecedented in its time and unequaled since, making it worthy of inclusion here. But there are, in addition, a few curious details in the last 3 minutes of the work, which are often overlooked, that I wish to point out to you that inform my decision. With the prevailing threat of further incursions of the Ottoman Turks into Europe had been quelled by the Holy League siege which liberated Vienna in 1683, 2 residual gifts were left behind as the Turks departed. The first was many bags of green coffee beans acquired by a clever businessman who opened a few coffee houses. However, the strong, bitter coffee was not popular until he came up with the idea of adding schlagobers, or whipped cream. The other gift was the exotic sound of Turkish military bands known as janissaries. These percussion instruments included drums, the triangle, and cymbals, which made a big impression on Mozart, who used them in several of his operas, as did Beethoven to tremendous effect in the choral finale of his Symphony No. 9. Having carried his orchestral forces through three-quarters of an hour of voluminous sound, he felt compelled to top it off with a rousing conclusion that would leave his audience breathless with awe and delight, a memorable musical experience like no other. But he leaves us with a mystery, which, to the best of my knowledge and research, has never been fully explained. Why does he repeat the final fragmentary motif exactly 17 times? Let's listen and count. Beethoven's Symphony No. 9 was composed between 1822 and 1824 and first performed in Vienna soon after its completion. But if we could describe Beethoven's final work as a fantastic symphony, another upstart composer was making a name for himself in France with a number of rather radical creations, including a daring work which he boldly called by that name, the Symphonie Fantastique. The young Frenchman was, of course, Hector Berlioz, who single-handedly carried the symphonic form into whole new territory in 1830, a mere 6 years after Beethoven's Ninth. In this work, Berlioz described in music an episode in the life of an artist who falls in love with a femme fatale, is rejected, and decides to end it all with a dose of poison. Instead of dying, he experiences a hallucinatory dream in which he has murdered his beloved, is led to his execution by guillotine. We actually hear the fall of the blade and the bouncing severed head in the music. And finally, his tormented soul in hell, mocked by the spirit of his beloved. Berlioz provides us with a vivid musical description of the event using the famous Dies Irae Gregorian chant theme, thrice repeated at doubling speeds for the grand throbbing finale.
Thank you.
how wrong it would be to present this survey without including a Brahms fantastic finale, and there are several to choose from. But since we are restricting ourselves to symphonies, then I would conclude that his most exciting symphonic finale comes in his first symphony. Born in 1833, a mere 6 years after the death of the grand master of the symphony, Beethoven, Brahms realized the awesome responsibility of composing a symphony in his shadow. Earliest sketches for a symphonic work appear when Brahms was about 22 years old, but no absolute first symphony as such came from his pen until he was well into his early 40s. It had to be perfect, well, as close to perfect as possible, and it proved to be so. The finale of his first symphony ends with an obvious spirit of exaltation, as if to proclaim, "I have made it." Okay, there is one other Brahms finale I just can't ignore. That would have to be the last few minutes of his Academic Festival Overture, Opus 80. Brahms composed the work in the summer of 1880 as a tribute to the University of Breslau, which had notified him that it would award him an honorary doctorate, and they expected him to compose an appropriately dignified work for the occasion. Instead, Brahms pulled off a musical prank on the stodgy academics. He started off the overture with great nobility, then suddenly breaks into a medley of student college songs. The profs were, of course, appalled, but the students loved it. In his finale, however, he gave his colleagues what they wanted, more or less, by topping it off with a rather ribald Was kommt dort von der Hohe, What is coming from afar, with a lofty college hymn, Gaudiamus igitur. Some of you may remember Sigmund Romberg's beloved musical, The Student Prince, the film's version starring Mario Lanza, in which the tune makes the prominent appearance. Actually, the lyrics lament that youth gives way to old age and finally to the grave, and if you would like to look for the departed profs of yore, you might look up to heaven, but most likely you will find them in the underworld. So enjoy wine, women, and song, etc. You gotta love this work.
Thank you.
My first introduction to the music of the Czech composer Bedřich Smetana came through a hearing of his lovely symphonic poem, Moldau, a description of the lovely river Vltava that runs through Prague, capital of the Czech Republic. I eventually learned that this piece was only one of six symphonic poems that make up a larger work called Maflast, or My Fatherland. I immediately sought this out and fell in love with the whole work, which is now represented in my collection by six or more recordings. The best one of all is a DVD performance by a Czech youth orchestra. Can you believe it? This monumental six-movement patriotic tribute to Smetana's own country was composed over a period of 7 years, 1872 to 1879. The six movements represent Czech history, mythology, nature, and conclude with the promise of a bright future with Blanik. The final pages of Blanik refer back to the beautiful harps passage of the first movement, here played by the full powers of the orchestra, synchronized with a great Hussite hymn, All Ye Who Are Warriors of God, concluding with brass fanfares. It would be a big mistake to ignore the Frenchman Charles-Camille Saint-Saëns, who has given us such wonderful music as the Carnival of the Animals, the Danse Macabre, the grand opera Samson and Delilah, the first soundtrack for a movie, L'Assassinat du Duc de Guise of 1908, and of course the Grand Symphony for Organ and Orchestra. Saint-Saëns' third and final symphony was composed in 1886 on a commission from the Royal Philharmonic, and premiered in London that very same year. Of it, the composer said, "What I have here accomplished, I will never achieve again." Any performance of the organ symphony is an auditorium filler, although musical purists scoff at its popularity and importance. Saint-Saëns' organ symphony should not be mistaken for an organ concerto, which it is not. In fact, the organ is treated for the most part as another instrument in the body of the orchestra, sometimes silent, sometimes merely quietly supporting a sequence of music. But for our purposes, we turn to the final movement in which the organ takes pride of place in a very big way, proclaiming in full voice its dominant role over the full orchestra. Well, when we turn to the Russian composer, Peter Ilyich Tchaikovsky, there is no dearth of crash-bang orchestral finales. I need only cite the ever-popular Overture 1812, performed by orchestras across the U.S. celebrating our national holiday of independence. Although it has nothing to do with the U.S., it's all about the Russian victory over the French in the War of 1812. Go figure. There's the finale of the March Slav, the last movement of the Third Suite, the Fourth Symphony, the glorious end of the Swan Lake Ballet. Wow. I had a struggle here, deciding finally to present the finale of the Fifth Symphony of 1888, premiered in St. Petersburg. Best, I think, of the six he wrote.
Thank you.
But I was challenged by the reconstructed ending of a symphony Tchaikovsky never finished, falling between the number 5 and number 6. He completed the first movement, but was dissatisfied with its progress thereafter, and decided to transform it into a piano concerto, his number 3. This was done to the big first movement, leaving 2 additional movements as mere sketches. After his death, his friend Taneyev fleshed out the 2 fragments, giving us a complete, though rarely performed, piano concerto number 3. Admittedly, a Russian composer of our own time, Simon Bogatyrev, touched up the 2 sketchy movements of the Tchaikovsky-Taneyev concerto finale, adding an arrangement of another Tchaikovsky piano piece for a scherzo, fleshed out to the powers of a full orchestra for a very dramatic conclusion. This version so impressed Eugene Ormandy that he decided to record the premiere with a sacrosanct Philadelphia orchestra, labeling it the Symphony No. 7. So here it is. The Czech composer Antonín Dvořák seems to have suffered a long germination period in the composition of his symphonies, culminating ultimately in the much-beloved New World Symphony, composed while he was employed in the United States. Many years ago, we may remember that this symphony appeared on LPs as the number 5, and then a few years later as the number 9. So what happened? His 2 earliest works in this genre date to within a few months of each other in 1865, written for the most part to impress a girlfriend. By the time he got to his New World, he himself marked it number 5, even though there were not merely 4 previous efforts, but actually 8. In our generation, the 4 discarded efforts were reinstated in the numbering and arguably deserve some recognition. But the best of the nine are the final three, 7, 8, and 9. So you would expect to be hearing the grand finale of the New World, but that is not to be. The Symphony No. 8 is a brilliant work, in my opinion, unjustly ignored, and it is the fantastic finale of that symphony that I now present to you. Notice the way in which Dvorak teases you in the slow development, which then explodes into a wild Czech dance and a crushing conclusion. Even the most avid lovers of the symphony would readily admit that if there is one composer who poses the greatest challenge, it is Anton Bruckner. Profoundly spiritual and naive, he allowed himself and his symphonies to be manipulated by others, so that the avid Brucknerite CD collector will own as many as 2 and 3 versions of the same symphony. But as a composer, he was a master. His monumental symphonies, more than the usual 4 contrasting movements, are rather massive blocks of sound that often defy the attention span of the most devoted listener. But sometimes Bruckner can astonish us with his energy and power, as he does in his overwhelming Symphony No. 8, approximately 80 minutes in length, composed between 1884 and 1892. This work ranks high in my CD collection, which has the additional distinction of being among the first recordings made in 2-channel stereophonic sound, an experimental tape made in 1944 in Nazi Germany, conducted by a very young Herbert von Karajan. Listening to this recording across the span of more than 7 decades is an amazing experience, especially the throbbing, long-expected finale, as we hear in this modern recording. mention the name of the Finnish composer Jean Sibelius, and the one work which comes immediately to mind is Finlandia, his patriotic tribute to his native land, then under the thraldom of Russia. Sibelius composed a variety of abstract music, but is best known for works which reflect some aspect of his Finnish heritage. Of his seven symphonies, numbers 1 and 2 are the most appealing, the other 5 receiving somewhat less attention in U.S. concert halls. Best of these 2 is the number 2, that is the most accessible, filled with drama, passion, and emotion. The final movement builds with deep, dark tension to a glorious crescendo like a grand chorale, throbbing and pulsating with emotion. Among our more contemporary composers, Dmitri Shostakovich is a fairly difficult musical nut to crack, loved by professional musicians and conductors of the big orchestras worldwide, but somewhat harder to please concert audiences. Of his 15 symphonies, most of them carry intense political implications, meeting the official requirements of the Soviet regime, but often with internalized meanings understood only by his most faithful advocates. More than once, he was severely criticized by the authorities for composing chaotic music unfit for the tastes of Soviet citizens. His Fifth Symphony was written in 1937 and first performed to celebrate the 20th anniversary of the October Revolution. The regime saw it as proof that the composer had been rehabilitated in conformity with party doctrine, but the audience at that first performance had another opinion of it. The applause went on for an entire hour. People were in an uproar and ran up and down the streets of Leningrad, hugging and kissing each other. The common people saw in it the message of sorrow, suffering, and isolation stretched on the rack of the Inquisition. The shrill repetitions of the A at the end of the symphony were described by one famous musician were like a spear point jabbing in the wounds of a person on the rack. It is a very powerful conclusion of extreme, almost unbearable tension. which now brings us to my final finale, what I consider the biggest, best, grandest finale in the symphonic literature, an apt parallel and equal in grandeur to the work which began our survey, Beethoven's finale of the Choral Symphony No. 9. Many years ago, the Borders Books and Records store at the Strip Mall in North Canton was the scene of a monthly program on music presented by various personalities. These programs were well attended, often attracting audiences of 30 or 40 people. On one occasion, I participated in a panel Q&A with four other people. Gerhard Zimmerman, music director, at one end. Next was Ken Viant, who worked at the store and sponsored the event. Assistant conductor Peter Stafford Wilson, WKSU classical radio DJ Mark Pennell, and me at the far end of the table below the salt. One member of the audience asked each of us to name our favorite composer, and right down the line it was Mahler, 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 Mahler. It must be a man thing, somebody in the audience shouted. At any rate, I think you will agree that the finale of the Symphony No. 2, The Resurrection, is a blockbuster by any standard. Well, Well, you have just heard are 14 of my favorite fantastic finales, and I am sure that many of you who have listened to this program have your own favorite fantastic finales not covered here. If so, contact Nathan Maslick here at the Canton Symphony Office and tell him what it is, and perhaps we can assemble another Fantastics Finales program in the future.